Hello, everybody.
Hello, everybody.
It is Dave Webster here, Identity Crisis Design, waiting for my guest to appear. I certainly hope I got the time right. But you know what?
You can't rush art.
And since he is an artist and I'm waiting for him, I guess, you know, we only want the best. Who here? Melissa Jane, Divinity, what's going on? If I'm going to let some time go by, and if I don't see a whole lot of action, I will throw out the link to come on in, and we'll just make it like a potluck dinner or something like that. So anyways, the thing that I was going to be talking about today with my writer had everything to do with the comic I'm working on, and that is going to be this guy here. I'm kind of penciling in the blue right now, and basically what it was about was, okay, I guess, yeah, so Julius is going to be in here pretty soon. Composition. So I had some layouts figured out and sent them over to Julius, because you want to get an outside opinion. That way you're not just, you know, seeing things from that one point of view. You already know the story, and the hard part is getting people who don't know it to understand it just as well as you do. So it's really important to get this layout here. Right. Open up this PDF. So I'll stop that screen and present this other screen window there. Right. So, and this is basically what? Yeah. Where am I here? From the fifth page that I was working on that I just finished, this is the page that I'm working on now. Originally, this is what the page looked like. And then the following page, and I sent all this out to Julius, and he managed to, let's see if I can open this one to get it right. There's my edit, and then there's his edit, and his edit is a lot, it makes more sense. It's not gonna let me do it because reasons. I'll figure this out. It's not even really a boomerang thing. There's so much crap on my computer that trying to navigate through all of it, and I try to keep it organized, but sometimes I don't understand my own organizational file of conventions or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, so we'll open up through here, because this is basically what we're going to be talking about anyways. Okay, so I'll stop this. Try to stick here with the comments, make sure everybody's not talking and I'm not seeing them. Stop screen, present, share, window. If I don't do it, say it out loud, then it won't actually happen. Right. So you can see all this, you know, text off to the side, which is basically, this is just a cheap storyboard. What I want the page to end up looking like, but it's just basically, it's rough. Page after, and that's the one that I'm actually working on right now. In fact, it might be easier for me to just share the whole window, because, okay, because, yeah, that's page 5. Okay, that's the page I'm working on now. Open up page 5, because page five is basically done, except for the lettering and all that. Okay, that's what that looks like. And so you can see the similarity between the layout and the finished page. Now, the reason it's got purple and stuff over there, that has everything to do with Germs is an idiot. What's up, man? It's disorganized. What were the organized? There's a guy out there on YouTube calling himself Organized Chaos, but that's basically what it is. But it has more to do with me not being able to settle on just doing like one thing. If I was doing like just comics, but I'm not. I've got all this other crap happening, and it just makes things tough to. What am I doing here? Stop this real quick. I wanted to import a couple of things here so I can show you basically what the last thing is that I've got going on that's done. I need to import these anyways. Yeah. And this is all like sometimes I'll get called to do a custom paint. You're welcome, Germs. Thanks. Germs. Yeah, Jeff is pretty cool. His channel's something else. It's Hit Bash Federation on YouTube, which is I think it's a very, very cool model making channel. So I got a call from a designer, a guy that does storyboard work. He does some work for different advertising agencies. And every once in a while, somebody will call up that they need like paint work done or something like that. And I ended up working on a giant, this is basically a giant 4-foot cupcake that's supposed to hold other cupcakes. These leaves here, they all open up like that plant from Little Shop of Horrors and holds cupcakes. I had to go out there for like 2 days to mess with this thing. And I have to get it all done this week because, and then striped out these fenders and this tank. And I have to get it all done this week, because starting tomorrow is a big dig project in my yard. One of the first times I got into a stream with the expert, I was showing him some action camera from the inside of my septic tank, which is collapsing. So I have people coming in with a mini backhoe because the thing is situated under the deck, and it's been this huge, it's been occupying a lot of my brain space, you know, a lot of my concern space. And tomorrow it's actually getting started, and you know, it's going to be expensive. I don't know if I'm going to have to replace the whole thing yet. Hopefully I can just put a new lid on it and that'll be that. But for the last 2 months, the only toilet in the house flushing it has been like a roll of the dice. Literally playing craps. This is my trash compactor show. My trash compactor show beer koozie. It's some Comicsgate lore there. So anyway, so this is page 5. I'm working on page 6, and the layout for that is here. So just to give you guys an idea, when I turn on this layer underneath, if you can see that, is that the right one? No, this light. Blah, 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 blah. Nope. This one. No, this one. Yeah, that's what I thought. This one, when I crank it all the way up, you can see this is Julius's original edit. And I thought that it might be a better idea to change the perspective in this second panel here. So I did. I wanted it to be a little bit more of a top-down shot. Yeah, Melissa, it is fun times. nothing makes you more relaxed while you're sitting on the toilet wondering if this is the last time or you're going to have to call a plumber or whatever. You can see, you can see the image, but the screen is black or blank. I'm just turning on and turning off layers here. That's all. One of these is Julius's layouts. What he's thinking is a better way to tell the story visually, and I have to agree. I don't have to agree, but I do. This is going to be the page after that. And the reason why all this stuff looks stretched out is because you can't see the shared screen. That's weird. Let me see. Hide. I'll try it again. Share screen. Entire screen, screen one. Okay. How about now? I'll just wait to see if that's weird. StreamYard is sharing my screen. Says it's sharing my screen. I'm hoping you can see it. Good. Okay, good to go. Maybe it's the switching back and forth between everything, but I'm sharing the entire monitor. I'm not sharing just like one window. Okay. Blah, blah, blah. So where was I? This is going to be the page that I have not worked on yet. I might as well bring the other ones up so that you guys can see where we're at so far, because I've got some one clip. Where's right? Page one. Why am I not seeing page two? Okay. It's not you, it's me. Well, shit, okay. This is page two, and I'm not putting the dialogue in. Yeah, page two, no dialogue. So you can see what's going on here. We've got a, what's up, Paul Vandertak from Facebook, one of my pinstriper buddies from across the pond, as they say. Panel one, panel two, we're taking out the only light so that our hero can remain undetected. And get inside. He needs to get inside the building. There's bad guys afoot. And we want to make sure that they don't get away with whatever they're trying to get away with. So we're basically using our friend here that we just jumped on as a human shield. I don't know if you guys can see this, but it works like this. He's got a hook around his neck, and he's got a hook going under his crotch there, holding him in front of him, threatening to cut off his junk if he doesn't do exactly as he says. Thanks, Jean-Paul. I'm going to say Jean-Paul because it's how we say it here in America. Yeah, so far it's going good. There's a lot of stuff going on in life and such. In fact, to the pinstriping thing, I was going to be at a pinhead meet last weekend, but I had used up all of my vacation days. And the last one being used up to wait for a plumber. So I couldn't spend it on or the money on like a hotel room or anything like that. And page four, and then page five just got finished. So it's not like I'm moving right along. I've been working on this thing for like a while. And then page five is where we see everything is in the dark. Did I just close that one? I just closed it because I've got bad aim. So yeah, everything's in the dark, and then we see our guy going downstairs, and bad guy going downstairs gets hooked with the razor sharp meat hook and pulled in like a fish right through the Achilles tendon. than our mess that somebody is going to have to clean up. And I imagine it's going to be these here rats. It was over close, not too far away. The meeting, the pinhead meet was over in East Liverpool, Ohio, just across the river. It's the first one that I've missed, I think, since I've been getting invited. But it's just a bunch of guys that are, you know, doing pinstripe work and, you know, talking shop, telling stories and stuff like that. Horror stories, like customer stories, stories about doing this. Sort of like there's there's a convention of just catchers, like in baseball, and it like once a year it's like just the catchers get together and hang out because only the catchers understand the game from that perspective. Everybody else is facing the other way literally when you're playing the game. I always thought that was interesting. It's like only the kickers knows what it's like to be a kicker. But since we have, you need to do some lives reacting to stuff, I understand. I do too. This is actually the costume forward, frontwards and backwards that I have to keep this up, honestly, when I'm drawing the character, because it's not super, even though I created it, it's not super in my head. I keep changing, but I just want to make sure that it's, you know, that it's accurate. There is a, what do you call it? See if I'll open the pictures here, but he's basically wearing a straitjacket with the hands that are opened up. Normally a straitjacket is something and you can't do anything with your hands. So I'm gonna go characters here. Yeah, so I've got some images here that are all about reference material, like those are his boots. And in page 2, you can see the bottom of this soul right here coming at you. This is Houdini's literal straitjacket. So you can see that, and this is from the back. So it's a bit of a cleaned up version. You know, this one's been torn and re-sewn together and leather and stuff like that. So it's modeled after this. That's also the back. So you can see, let's see if I pull this up here. You can see the way that, you know, the straps go across here. It's basically the same. I have to simplify it a little bit just so that I can, I don't want it to be more difficult than it has to be, but you know, this is what it looks like from the front. And you can see on this one, I would have to go back into the file and mess with it because I had not figured out what I was going to do with the back yet. I don't think I had found those pictures. But this one here, this one looks like just like badass to me. But you can see like over time, it's gotten beat up. This is what it looked like originally. And as he has torn through it, I imagine in an attempt to get out of it, that, things have eroded and decayed and whatever. John Paul, that's the other thing. This is the first time I think that Wizard hasn't been at a pinhead meet because he was actually at SEMA, which is, 200 times bigger. And I've only ever heard stories about going to SEMA and how big it is and how you need like, a whole day to get through it. Thanks, Melissa. So around my character's wrists, and the character he's called Meat Hook as a consequence of other people seeing him in action in the streets. And it's just sort of a moniker that, it's people just start using it because he has these things hanging off of his hands. But those straps, those straps are basically made of, Kevlar, which is kind of like bulletproof material, or it's supposed to be very, very strong. so that he wouldn't be able to cut through it himself. This is the original drawing I had from like a long time ago. I just had that smiley face on there and I really liked it and I wanted to do something with it. But a lot of these drawings are they're older, they're you know, like the pants aren't tucked in, and I was still trying to figure out exactly what it is I want to do with it. Like this here. In some of the earlier versions, this is not a strap here. It looks more like a onesie. And you know, Julius was like, you know, it should probably change that. I'm like, yeah, it doesn't look right. I was only just, you know, trying to figure it out here and there. Let's see what's going on. Oh, you know, what his pants might look like and all this stuff. And this is everything I have in the folder for that main character. Anyways, that's the thought process. And then Julius is working on his comic. This is just a piece of art that I did for him, for his main character. This is Angela Peretz. You guys want to check this story out? It's on Indiegogo. In fact, I should put, you have to put the link in the chat. Yeah, I saw that, John Paul. I will check that out in just a second. So far, that's what's going on with the comic. And I'm going to get back to, yeah, here. And that's the page that I'm working on. But let's do this. Let me share something so we can all talk about. You guys might dig this. I saw this earlier today. If I can get to it. Brave tab. Is it this one? Yeah, it's this one. Let me get rid of this. Oh. Hey, Julius, if you're... hold on a second. Is that the right one? Or is this the right one? I'm boomering. Okay, this is... Hold on a second. Let me turn this down a little bit. This is a day in the life at Twitter. I don't know if you guys can see this okay. Let me know. All right, there I go. Okay, you guys can, what the hell is happening? Okay, you guys can see this, and I will hit play. That's funny, we have those same kind of key cards at my job. All right, this is amazing, and I can't believe, I would be upset if I got fired from this job, too.
Welcome to a day in my life as a Twitter employee. So this past week, went to SF for the first time at a Twitter office, badged in. Honestly, took a moment to just soak everything in. What a blessing. Also, started my morning off with an iced matcha from the Pert. Then I had a meeting, so quickly scheduled one of these little pods. Rooms, which were so cool. They're literally noise canceling. Took my meeting, got ready for lunch. Look how delicious this food looks. Oh my god.
This makes me hungry and tired.
Then made my way down to this log cabin area. I don't know what this is, but it was really cool. Played some foosball with my friends to kind of unwind.
Unwind. Okay. I gotta know.
Found this really cool medicine.
Sorry, I can't. Unwind from what exactly? You know? I want to hear that again, okay? Because they're going to a foosball table so that...
Then made my way down to this log cabin area. I don't know what this is, but it was really cool. Played some foosball with my friends.
Listen for it.
Unwind. Also found this really cool meditation room that I thought was super neat. I didn't do any yoga, but they have this yoga room if you are a yogi, so also thought that was really cool. Had a couple more meetings in the afternoon, had a ton of projects that we needed to knock out. Say hey to my teammates. went to the library to kind of get some more work done. Obviously had to have our afternoon coffee, so made some espresso. And then before leaving for the day, had some red wine that's on tap.
Red wine on tap.
Just honestly enjoyed the beautiful laptop.
Okay. Like red wine on tap. Night shift. Yeah, John Paul. Night. I have a night shift working on a railroad. We have a storm over. She want to trade for a day. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I would take that job, but it would be a lot better if it wasn't in San Francisco. You know, because once you walk outside the door, you know, you got to look out for those human fecal minds.
Honestly enjoyed the beautiful weather. So awesome trip.
Yeah, awesome trip. Wouldn't you be upset if you got fired from that job, man? I know I would be. What do you mean? What do you mean I don't get to work in this playroom anymore? Okay. I did pose this question earlier on Twitter, and my friend got back to me with his answer is oleon spread. I don't know what that is. The question was, it was a statement, really. There is no more worthless condiment on the planet than Miracle Whip. Change my mind. He said oleon spread. I don't know what that is. I might think about finding it just to see. If it comes in like little packets, Miracle Whip should not come in a big jug. It should just come in those little packets so it doesn't take up space in your refrigerator after you open it once. I think that Miracle Whip is a giant con.
Ain't life a motherfucker.
All right. What else do we got going on here? I was posting about this here stream going out there. Oh, what's everybody doing Tuesday? Anyone? I've got my day figured out. But then I'm also like working at night. So thank God there's not going to be a ton of people around. I can listen to the returns come in. What I'm looking forward to the most is all of the independent video going to be dropped at all of the different drop boxes that people are scared they're being watched. Okay. Here we are. Say hi to the people, Julius.
Hello, can you hear me?
Say hi to the people. I can hear you. In fact, that's quite an audio setting you've got.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm talking in the microphone.
Okay, so I was just trying to entertain people here. I didn't know if I was working or not. I was playing that video about a day in the life at Twitter.
Oh yeah,
see that?
Yeah, I saw that.
Dude, is that what it's like everywhere over there or just in that building?
I would imagine like, running a company like Twitter would be nothing but code monkey work, as the term is known in the IT world. At least that's what it's told to me from some of the IT people I've acquainted with over the years. Mm-hmm. And so I was watching right now a bit of your live stream, which, by the way, I didn't know you were going to go live. I thought we were going to do a one-on-one.
You got to get out there, man. Yeah.
I wanted to discuss the latest pages I've edited for your book, and I didn't want to.
But do you think it's a bad idea to talk about that out in the open?
We could talk about the pages you're drawing now, but not the new ones, because new ones kind of, they may potentially have spoilers, and I don't want to, you know, spoil it for the crowd.
Okay. All right. If you want to, we can do that. We'll talk about the ones that we got now, your impressions, maybe. We can do that.
Yeah, we can do that.
Switch it over to private. We'll just talk in the aftermath.
Yeah. Okay. That sounds good.
All right. Cool. Now, one of the things that's actually bugging me is that my page 2 clip, I've got some of it, I've got everything on Dropbox, and for crying out loud, I cannot get that thing to update the way that I want it to save my life. And I'm looking for page 2 clip, and I can only see page 2.
page two clip? What does that mean?
Clip being a clip studio. And probably the reason is because it was a traditional page that I didn't do anything with in clip studio.
I see.
It was like a physical page. So I'll open this one in clip and then share the screen. So anyways, just to introduce you to some, there's some, what do we have still in the chat here? I'm not sure. Let me see. I got your Indiegogo link out there too. Everybody got to go back. Man, this is some real JPEG-y video on this here. is it just me or is it really, really bad?
What do you mean?
The video, like the video quality on this.
I can see you kind of getting pixelated, but
holy crap, that's terrible.
There's a delay on your feed that from my end. I don't know if the people watching have the same problem, but I could see you kind of dragging.
Yeah, well, I was looking at, I'm gonna like quit some stuff. I shouldn't have to because it's like it's a Mac, so it's amazing and everybody knows it. But
all right, but is it an old Mac or is it a new Mac?
It's actually a trash can Mac, the trash can looking ones, but it's new to me. I'm just really surprised that it's I mean, I don't have a lot of browser windows open or anything like that.
It could just be your internet, man.
Oh man, it
could just be that.
Well, that's better. I closed a Twitter window, or did I?
They heard you play that video and they got mad at you, so they started fucking with your internet.
on the YouTube side, you look good. I look like crap.
Well, I mean, I'm not on camera, so
yeah. But I'm just whatever.
I'm not taking up bandwidth by having the camera go going.
The fatter I get, the more bandwidth I take up. okay, so I'll share the screen for page one.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Sorry for the long pause in between when we talk. It's just that I've been so busy. The guy who originally hired me to write his horror comic decided to make it into a movie. So he currently has an Indiegogo right now called The Last Thanksgiving, which I'm gonna adapt into a screenplay. So I've been working on that.
Really?
Yeah. It's interesting to kind of.
I was here first.
What was that? Well, that's why I wanted to do the private stream so I could, you know, go over new pages with you.
That's fine. Okay. Well, is that Welcome to Hillview horror film?
No, the Last Thanksgiving.
No, it says that, but like in the here, I'll just.
Oh yeah, sure. So you can, so whoever is watching and listening can check it out in their spare time if they want. It's raising funds to shoot. He wants to make a independent movie, an indie film, a horror movie that is a homage to the slasher movies of the 80s, but with a modern take on it, a modern twist, which is kind of cool. I like the brought to the table here. Yeah, that's it. That's it.
How does it look on your end? Does it look pixelated?
No, it looks good to me.
Huh. All right. So it's going to be, it's probably the camera then.
It might be the camera.
Yeah. All right. That's fine. I mean, as long as it's coming through, like whatever if I'm sharing my page and other stuff, I don't necessarily need to look nice and good and sharp and whatever, but the stuff that I'm sharing, you know, as long as
you want me to share it, you want me to share it on my end? Maybe them.
No, help? I mean, if what I'm sharing looks good is fine. I don't need me to look good. I just want to make sure if I'm sharing a screen, like a comic book page, that it doesn't come across looking like I look right now.
Right.
Okay. So, all right. All right. So, whoop, wrong guy. I'm going to get the other one back up, share screen. I'm just going to do the entire window. It's going to make it easier to go from. Hello. All right. Yeah. Page one. And this is one that we decided to the way that it was being written in the bubbles and we're going to go right across the middle. And honestly, looking at this now, I can't believe that we got them to fit in there the way that we did. You know what I mean? Because it was like it managed to flow across where that boarded up window is. It didn't interrupt the panel with the cameras on the mask and introduce things. Like, I was really impressed. The first time you brought that up, you sent that across to me, I was like really impressed with it.
Yeah, and because I've been lettering for a few years now, and the number one thing that every letterer in every book that's ever written about lettering has said is you don't want to cover the art. You want to cover the least amount of art. And if you are going to cover the art, cover the dead space. Don't cover up the important stuff that the reader needs to look at. So when I saw initially, do you have the original page by chance? The one you sent me or no?
This is it, actually. This is
the lettered one.
The lettered page.
Yeah.
First
letter page that you sent me.
Yeah, I try to save everything, so it's
okay. Because if you have it, then we can use that for context for those who are watching. They can have some context to how as to what we're talking about when we just said about maybe the flow.
Let me see. That might be because I know I have a finals folder, and I have a pages folder.
Oh, okay. And I try to do the same thing too. I try to save the old files so I can compare and contrast and kind of see. Okay, yeah, this works better or this doesn't work better. Clip.
And it might be in page, okay, issue one finals. Now, this is the final JPEG. This isn't, this might be it. Yeah, because there's one and, there's one and 1B. Okay, so, that's one. And I guess we figured there was like way too much dialogue there. And then let me get the 1B open and see if this is, because this is what we settled on.
Yeah. I think I had you, shrink the size of the font.
No, yeah, but there was also something else though, and I think that's where it comes up in the PDF, is that the,
I think
the
also I had the, you, I had you, I guess, mesh together the narration boxes as opposed to overlapping.
Right. Let's see here. The narration boxes. Yeah.
That, see how they overlap, and that one they kind of blend. I don't want to say blend together, but I guess they mesh together. They're like almost like their own.
Yeah, they're all one. Like they're one solid shape.
Yeah.
There was one. Let me see if I can open up the open. Go asphalt pages. Finals, and then it's going to be this 1B PDF. Yeah, and this is the very final thing here was there. This.
Oh, that's right. That's the final.
The circle window, right? And the other thing was the radio bubbles. I changed to what you were using. I like those a lot better. They're a lot easier to handle too. I mean.
Yeah, and as you can see, look how compared to the first, second, and third, how much we shrunk, but also made sure that the artwork itself wasn't completely covered up.
Yeah, that it didn't.
And it's a nice line down, you know, the squiggle line, the backwards, I guess the backwards S, for lack of a better term.
I can do this. Yeah.
The snake-like. You know, flow of the word balloons and the narration boxes.
Am I getting this? Is this right? No, that's not right. There, that's what I want. That one. And that one. Yeah, it's a little curvy on that one, but it's just, it looked like those, like that, the electricity going around there. That was just a pain in the butt. trying to get that stuff to go around corners and things,
right?
Because I'm using the two, I'm using that one, it's that word balloon method where there's the balloon, there's the outline, then there's the tail, and they all exist on their own different layers,
right?
And trying to keep track of that, it's like herding cats. It once you get used to it, I'm sure it's, you know, let's see, let's go on to, I'll open up page 2 PSD. This one doesn't have dialogue in it. but that was one of the things that I had to get used to, was that the amount of dialogue that we did not put in this.
Yeah, I remember the original page.
It was like basically told the whole thing.
Yeah.
This is everything you need to know about reading this book. If you stop, if you stop reading right now, you know what I mean? Like, you don't need anything else.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And that was, but that's the thing. It's like, I'm already too verbose, even like in my speech, you know what I mean? So,
there's a term that a lot of, heroes in various anime and movies. I don't know about movies, but anime specifically, is they always use the term, oh, you talk too much.
Monologuing. He's like in The Incredibles. He's monologuing. Yeah, he's monologuing. What does he start doing? He starts monologuing. I hate when they monologue. Like, if brevity is the soul of wit, dude, I am the most unfunny person on the planet. that's my whole thing.
And this page was a great page too. And again, you know, you want to showcase the art. You want to showcase the sequential storytelling skills when drawing comics. And you don't want to bog down the page with too much narration. I mean, it's okay to have some narration. Obviously, you need exposition. You need to inform the reader what the hell's going on, what the character's thinking. But sometimes, like in this instance, you want them to at least know or ask and be curious.
Yeah.
What is this? What's going on? I want to find out more.
Well, that's one of the things about this project is it's first time ever. It's not the first time drawing, but it is the first time writing, the first time really doing sequential art. And it's that thing where I'm hyper aware of all of the things that I don't know. So while I'm not necessarily going to say, like, listen to absolutely everything that you have to say and agree with it, because some of the stuff that you suggest makes all the sense in the world unless you already know where the story is going to go. So I agree with a ton of it. And that's also like part of the learning process that I'm not used to. Most of the time when I'm doing something for a customer, like, there is no custom paint editor. You know what I mean? Actually there is, and it's the customer. And a lot of times they only know what they like, but it's not from a critical standpoint. You know, it's not they're the third disinterested party going, I don't know if I like the way those colors are going, or it's too high on the fender or something like that. And not only am I the only one making the decision, a lot of times I'm fighting against somebody who's got a bad idea and telling them, you know, like, why it's a bad idea.
Right. And now for me, it's practical.
You're educating me while I'm doing this. And
I'm practical on my approach. I've learned long ago as a writer, a comic book writer specifically, is that you got to let the artist figure it out on their own. And on top of that, you got to let the artist's style shine and kind of observe their strong points as well as their weak points. So that way you can guide them to, you know, focus on the strong points and then point out the weak points. So that way they can either work on it or hide it, you know, whatever the case. And for you, man, like you've been learning pretty fast, from the get-go. Like in the beginning, when we first started doing this, you know, it was you had this idea. You gave me what you thought. I worked it out. We hashed it out together.
Yeah.
And you know, I still respected your source material. I didn't try to change anything. Just try to keep it to where you were kind of thinking of where you wanted to go to.
Yeah. Well, I only ever wanted to make sense. And that's
Of course.
So if I'm like relying on you to tell me when something doesn't make sense.
And, you know, we're taking the route of like telling the story slowly, but then you came up with the idea of like, well, what if we just do like a Goodfellas type of deal where the first eight pages?
The first eight pages. Yeah. Cause it's
the first eight pages is like nothing but nonstop action. And I thought, dude, brilliant. That's, That's perfect. See, and that's
because when you go through the first couple of pages, like, all right, these people are going to meet, and then they're going to go here.
Yeah.
And now they're working on a car, and it's sort of like, this is just, I'm reading a comic book where everyday stuff is happening.
Right.
And I don't know if it was because that's a common gripe when you listen to a lot of the CG streams talk about how bad a comic book is.
Right. Yeah,
it's usually right. because of that, because, oh, look, somebody's sitting at the table right. on their cell phone drinking right. a latte, and this is a comic book now. This is an action. Okay, well, but there was another thing, and, man, I was only over at this person's house, like, one time, and they were, like, it was, like, a friend of a friend, and I've never been back there. I don't even remember any of their names. But this lady was writing a book, and one of the things that she had said that somebody else had told her was, you want to start it off with, a bang. Like, if you haven't seen it, and stop me if I've already told you this one, Joe Carnahan is the guy that directed Smoking Aces, The A-Team, things like that. And he had this personal project with Ray Liotta and Jason Patrick called Narc, which is one of my favorite movies. And it starts off, that opening scene is one of the single most intense opening scenes I've ever seen in a movie. And it's a foot chase through, like, projects and through this, you know, parts of Detroit. And it's like an adrenaline rush the entire time. Right after that, the movie goes into some exposition about how they got there. And it's very minimal, you know, there's, it's low key and it's brooding, the exact opposite of what you just were watching. But because they give you that launching point, now you are like, all right, I've got to give it some time here. Cause I want to know what the fuck just happened. Like, what did I just see? How did we get there? And, man, that movie delivers, like, on every level.
Yeah, that's like Heat. That's how Heat starts.
Yes. Yeah, it starts. Yeah, yeah, Heat, it starts with the Heat, starts with the robbery.
Movie Heat starts where it starts with the robbery, and you're like, "What the fuck is going on?" Mm-hmm. And you have that hothead asshole who almost ruins the entire operation because of his fucking arrogance. Yep. And
yeah,
and then yeah, by the end of it, you're like, "What the fuck is going on? What's happening?" And now you're vested. Now you want to find out what it's all about.
Dude, what a masterclass. Every Michael Mann movie is like that.
Yeah,
it is. I mean, and you know what I would have loved to seen them do, just as an aside? I would have loved to have seen them taken everybody and that was in the vice squad, whoever that cop, that, you know, high-end robbery squad,
mm-hmm.
and all of the criminals, just as the actors, laundry's done, and switch them. So that now Al Pacino is playing Robert De Niro's part and all that back and forth. Like, now you guys are the cop, and just film the whole movie again. Because that's basically what it is. The only difference is that one side of that equation believes in that there is a law, and the other one is like, well, no, there isn't. I'm outside the law. And there's just one thing that one believe that you believe in the law and we don't.
Right.
Other than that, they are both at the top of their, as criminals, top of their game, as cops, top of their game.
Yeah.
Same vulnerabilities, same personality quirks, you know, and I thought that was one of the things that was basically just, the whole movie was a mirror of one to the other, and that they're basically the same people, exactly the same people, just with that one thing. One believes in the law and the other one doesn't. Anyways, back to what we were talking. What were we talking about? No, yes. So, like, open it up with action to the extent that we could. And I've always, and I'm not going to go back and fix it because, one, things need to move forward. And I don't know if it's going to be exciting for everybody else, but I'm kind of, I'm anxious to see what the last page of this book looks like versus these first few pages. Because I'm not just, like, stumbling through telling a story sequentially. I'm also stumbling through traditional pages versus Clip Studio versus, like, page six I'm doing in Clip Studio on the iPad. and I want to do some in Procreate, and I want to experience all of it at once while this whole thing is going on. And who knows? I mean, I don't know how easy it is to take a book from black and white to color, but let me ask you this. You've done this before. You've gone black and white and you've gone color.
Yeah.
With two of your campaigns, Ghetto Dragon and then now Vigilant Fury. What do you think of that? The book will be in color as a, not a perk, as a, not a tier. What am I thinking of? As a
stretch goal.
Yes. Thank you. As a stretch goal. To take everything that we're saying here, because right now it's black and white. It's not black and white like Vigilant Fury is. You want it to have that noir look. I'm not necessarily going for that. But what's your opinion on that as a crowdfunding tactic?
I mean, depends, man. Like, is that, do you see a book or a story like this in color? Because you have to think about aesthetics when it comes to story. At least I do. You know, yeah. when I was looking for the artist for Vigilant Fury, I was specifically looking for an artist who could draw noir, who could draw heavy shadows, who kind of gave that, who came from the school of, who came from Frank Miller's school of thought, which is heavy inks, shadows, noir type of deal. Eduardo Rizzo from 100 Bullets. That's who I was looking for. So I wasn't looking for a Tom McFarlane or who was the other one? Greg Capullo. I was looking for the Frank Millers. Anyone who draws like heavy black and white shadow. I can't think of any other. Alex Maleev. I don't know if you know who Alex Maleev is or not.
I know that. I can't remember the name of the artist.
He drew Daredevil with Brian Michael Bendis.
Okay. Yeah.
Sean Phillips. Sean Phillips, another example. I was looking for that kind of style.
I don't remember who drew Torso, but that was a Brian Michael Bendis book.
I think. Didn't Brian Michael Bendis draw that himself?
Maybe. I mean, honestly, with that, the artwork there, I was able to follow everything, and that was great.
Yeah, yeah. Whatever the case, I was looking for an artist who could draw noir, can give me that look I wanted for Vigilant Fury. Same thing goes for Ghetto Dragon. Same thing goes for any other books that I'm involved with. I need the aesthetics need to match the story, or else the experience from the reader, it won't work. It will fall apart for the reader.
Well, and this one, I think, the only place I know where color would really benefit is there's going to be a scene where cars are involved. You know what I mean? And there's going to be like a, you know, root beer brown dart or something like that. And maybe I don't allude to that in the writing or anything like that. I do.
See, that's the thing. You have that now. You have to consider, is it worth doing this book in color for that? Is that the only reason why you want the book to be
in color? Not necessarily. In fact, I don't know that I think that I would be forgiven not doing the book in color just because it's like, well, how much heavy lifting is there supposed to be? You know, I know I'm going to get you to do the, if you can, the the lettering, because it's going to be maybe a load off. I don't know. The lettering was kind of fun though. For as much of a pain in the butt it was to do the radio bubbles. I might just want to be like, I'd rather pay someone else, you know, you know, it's not like, you know what I mean?
It does take time. It does take time to letter. Cause you have to, you know, like I said, figure out where to place the lettering.
Right.
You know, how like spacing it, it does take, it is definitely a skill set to have.
Yeah.
But to go back to your original question, I think it all depends on how you see this book. Do you see it as a black and white, or do you see it as a color book? It's either or. It just depends on the kind of story you are telling. If you think color would benefit the book, then I say why not? Why not go for the color? But
yeah.
Well, it's up to you, man. Like, you're the creator.
But then my other question would be, you know, from the original clip files, I'm like, you can see this one's got all manner of, and some of it is mislabeled. Like, I've got the floor here. That's probably all the same as the grays. I can probably put these two together.
Yeah, and see, now the way that you layered your pages, you could easily color the book, because you could just, you know, send the colorist pages that have no shading, and then you could just tell them to color it all. And they can give you a good a well-colored book. It just depends. Like I said, it just depends on what you're looking for.
Yeah, or at least do it well. And yeah, and some of this is because
it's a great page, by the way. I like how that page came out.
You didn't see this one already.
I don't think I saw it finalized the way you have it now.
Okay. Yeah, I was trying to mess around with like the shadows and stuff, and especially here, this looked really brooding to me. I don't know if you can like that part right there.
Yeah, no, I dig it. See, you made it work. You made it work.
Yeah, and then it was like I have to put the club name on his back right here too. I can't forget that. But you remember. Where did I just see this? I was reading the Lost Pages, the silhouette. They did it there. And in one of the Manly Tales books, I was doing a review on that. And I was like, you know, it's funny that I always see this whenever somebody is doing gore and whenever somebody gets just like lambasted across the face.
Yeah.
Somehow it's like the most damage that you could possibly do to a human body. I'm like, it always makes me laugh that somehow at least one, if not two eyeballs always remain intact just so that you can see them staring back at you from the panel.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Otherwise it would just be like more gore. Like, oh, look, everything is smashed to pieces, but the eyeballs somehow made it through. I always thought that was funny. I'm not laughing at them. Obviously, I'm laughing at myself because I've got one hanging out there, and it's not perfectly round. You know, it's like it was like even in like in every given Sunday, on any given Sunday, there's that one scene at the end where the guy gets hit so hard that they have to pick his eyeball up off the field, or smash mouth football. You know, it's every time it's with the eyeball coming out of the head. Let's see. And then page five, this is the last one that, and this was odd to me, because trying to figure out how these frames were supposed to work, in Clip Studio, to me, I was like, it's a little confusing,
but you made it work though. I really love the way you shaped the panels, and, it really gives it that 90s feel. And
well, yeah.
It's cool. I like it. I actually dig it. I think
it's such an what do you call it?
Like that one looks traditional, right? You got the straight lines, but the next the page afterwards with all the action, curved. It's I don't know. It adds a layer of.
I wanted to add some insanity to it.
And
more of a. And this is probably inadvertent. That it is a you're in my house now, you know, down here in the dark, this is where I do all my best work, and that it would be like this crazy fever dream nightmare thing where the panels are all crooked. But also I was noticing that everything up until that point was, you know, traditional frames.
Yeah.
And I was like, I feel like I need to get away from that. And then I also, I'm not going to change anything, but I feel like I kind of, for this page, it works great.
Yeah.
And it might be something that I want to make sure that I come back to later that,
I think you should.
When MeWe is up, turned up to 11, that this is the kind of thing that happens, weird Dutch angles and stuff. Mm-hmm. I added some rats, you know, and that those our little spider buddy over there. Where are they?
Oh, there they are. Okay, I see them.
Yeah, they're in the back there.
Okay.
Yeah, they were just, you know, black silhouettes with the eyes knocked out. It's basically the background you're looking through. They're a silhouette shape, but some of these were like I'm like, why am I giving myself like. The way that the bodies are positioned, how the perspective is working out, and I'm still not entirely happy with it. I'm just not as upset as I was. But this guy on the bottom here, like laying on the floor and then trying to get the perspective right with the steps, like nothing is like the steps go this way and they're already at an angle. And then he's on the floor and the floor is going to be at a certain angle. So how do I position his body? What am I drawing? What am I not drawing? What are you supposed to be able to see and not see? And I don't know. That was that one, that thing on the bottom there was tough.
Photo references, man. They're your friend. They're your best friends.
Well, yeah. I would, yeah, basically what, put a timer on the iPhone and then
I, you know, personally would have, let's see, I would have kind of put the camera behind the web, almost sorts. Mm-hmm. That's what I would have done. And kind of see what I get from that.
Oh, you mean just kind of like move it, dolly it over to the left?
Yeah, yeah, and see where that, but no, this angle is good too. It's just his body's a little awkward, if I'm being honest.
Yeah, it's, yeah, well, it's the foreshortening. It was the thing that was tough. And if you mean like awkward, like the way the limbs are bent or
the perspective. Perspective.
Yeah, the one arm is coming way out at you.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And that's also one of the, like, you can see that finger is missing.
Oh, okay.
You know what I mean? And I don't know if it's just going to be one of those things, like, honestly, working in Clip Studio Paint is great, and it also sucks. One, because there's a lot of moving parts, things that you can get lost trying to figure out how do I use this now or whatever. And also just the ability to undo. I totally understand why EVS likes to do stuff traditionally, because, you know, there is no going back, and it actually makes it, you know, the work is, I realize I'm saying this about a book that he's taken 2 years to produce. That maybe it doesn't, but you know what I mean? You know, like, I know there's a way to erase and undo things in a traditional format, but there's no undo button, you know? So there's, you're only going forward, I think, more often than when you're working with something like this.
That is true. EVS, he takes a lot of care in his work, which is why it's taken him 2 years to produce a, 32-page comic book or 24-page comic book?
Yeah.
So I understand that. You know, I understand he no longer has an editor telling him, hey, where is this at? I need this now. Like, I need this next week.
But I know he is asking other people. So, like, those books do go out before they're finished or when they're in a pre-whatever mode. They'll go out to different people to read, like four or five people. What do you think that he knows he's going to be able to get, like, an honest opinion from? I still don't know if I can do that. And that's mostly because I don't know that I question whether I actually know what I'm talking about or not. I know whether I like something or don't like something, but I'm not always really that great at explaining why I do or don't.
It does take a little bit of I guess understanding of the rules of storytelling and whether or not they're followed. So it doesn't matter your approach as long as the story has a beginning, middle, and end. So, like, for an example would be Memento, the film Memento, right?
Yeah.
That's a movie where if you go to the bathroom, you're not gonna know what the fuck's going on. You have to watch it from beginning to end to understand what is happening. But the way Christopher Nolan did it, which was during the editing process, was he shot the movie straight, but then he edited the movie to make, you know, to put it where it needed to be.
Right.
So, but that movie,
how else would you do it though?
Yeah, exactly.
It seems like that the only way you could.
And even though that movie unorthodoxly, like, started at the end, And it ended in the beginning, it still was beginning, the middle, and the end. The beginning, the middle, end of the story was not him looking for his wife, but him lying to himself to continue hunting for the killer who hurt his wife. And also leaving the question open, was it Sammy Jenkins? I think that was the name of the character. Remember Sammy Jenkins?
Who? The guy that Joe Pantaleone played?
No, the guy who when he was a caseworker for an insurance company, he was investigating this guy who also had memory loss.
Remember? Okay. I honestly, it's been a while since I've seen that movie.
Well, anyways,
different things stick out to me, but yeah. The way that he the way that the rest of the audience understands the context of what's going on versus him not knowing the context of what's going on. I thought
smart. I guess the point I'm trying to make is that even though Christopher Nolan used an unorthodox way of telling the story, it still had a beginning, middle, and I think any aspiring writer or a working writer should know the rules of storytelling to the point where they speak about it confidently, not because they're right. It's just because that's the name. That's just the tool set. That's what you need to tell a good story.
It follows the same rules of the.
So you can still, you could not enjoy it. You could look at a movie and go like, it wasn't for me, but you can still recognize it was still good though. It was still well done.
That's why I like when I first started doing this and I was looking up that and sometimes they just distill it down into the three parts, you know, your high point, your the pinnacle of the story, and then how it trails off. But it basically goes like this. And sometimes it'll be like an 8-part thing where, you know, like the hero's journey. There's a conflict. We have to go do this thing, learn, then we fail, then we group and come back. And then there's the, you know, the climax, you know, and then the resolution and all of that. And there's, you know, different ways to structure it, but it's, you know, sometimes it's more basic, sometimes it's more complicated, but it all generally, it, you know, like follows that rule. You know, there really is a YouTube channel out there for anything. And if for no other reason, it makes it so that whenever we're talking about it, I actually understand what the hell you're talking about. You know, that helps. You know, watch some videos about how to tell a story so that when I'm talking, you know what I mean. That helped. You still there?
I'm still here.
Yep. Okay. All right. I just want to make sure. But yeah, you know what I meant by all that.
I hope.
All right. So that's page 5. And then of course, what are we at now? Page 6. This is me laying out page 6. Oh, all right. This is one of the questions I had for you. And that's this. Let me get this here. Now, this is your, get rid of this. All right. This is the original layout at the Julius edit.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I go to Z for the Zoom and it never, okay. Okay, yeah, that's your edit. This is what I did over the top of it. So I'm just going to turn yours down so you can kind of see it. Now, originally, like we were saying, this is a standard medium shot on panel 2. And that somehow just didn't seem very exciting to me. So I changed the perspective to this.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay. Now, then, of course, I'm overthinking it a little bit. Then I thought, well, does it need to be this open? Because I don't think there's going to be a ton of dialogue in there, maybe. Or, and I'm just going to ask you your opinion, you think that or something like this?
The reason why you should keep it open is because you want to show the reader what he stepped into. And, right. And you don't get that from this angle. You get it from the second angle before this one, where you see the lights, you see the equipment, and the reader will immediately know exactly.
So if I wanted to convey the same thing, I would be, why is the pencil not working? I would be cramming too much stuff in here and here and all that.
Well, war balloon wise.
Right. And to the extent, I honestly don't remember what is being said there, if anything.
Yeah. And this one, you see, and
mostly you, see, it might you can be see up
the
equipment, here.
You can see the room, you can see the beds, and it's immediately, you know, okay.
I do want to put put a wheelchair here, just laying down on the side, you know, her wheelchair.
Yeah.
So that's good. So I'm going to, so I will drag this, just the one, I'm gonna drag that down to the trash. We don't need to worry about that. Goodbye, second thoughts. Okay. So then, since you are here and I am here, and I'm going to hide this. In fact, I'm just going to stop the screen real quick and share this Brave tab here. There we go. I thought it might not be a bad idea to watch your video for Vigilant Fury. How do you feel about that?
You don't have to.
No, I wouldn't mind it. I like the music. I always really dug that logo. That's an intelligent design to me.
Oh, thank you, man. I appreciate that.
And so let me ask you about, I guess we can talk about get this window back to normal size. Why am I not? Oh my goodness. I'm getting boomer juice all over the place. So when, who did the music?
The music was, it was a copyright free, song from, that I found on YouTube. Cause I was looking for copyright free music for like, intense action movie, music, that kind of deal. And I found a few, but they weren't copyright free until that one, where all they asked was, to give them the song credit in the description of the video if I used it. And I did, but I still got copyright strikes for some reason. So
you really did? I don't know. Did we see that?
No. What I mean is, like, they're gonna not flag it, but I guess what do you call it? They're not gonna push it. You're not gonna push the video forward. Like if if it goes viral or anything, it won't. They won't like. Yeah. I guess they're telling me. They're letting me. I guess they're going to shadow ban the show.
Okay. Well, we're not going to do that here.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about it. This this is actually I gotta show this because you bothered to. I'm going to do this again. So, I wish I could share more screen, more than one screen at a time. There. I mean, why not shill two birds with one stone? This is my version of Angela.
That's your version of Angela. Yep.
Yeah, and I remember at first because did I put a jacket on or was it just the two? No, different shoes.
It was different shoes, yeah.
And two, come on. Oh, yeah, different shoes and two machetes. And why is this not? That looks weird. Okay. But yeah, that's I would like to get a chance to get something like this in with the campaign whenever you do like your issue two or whatever.
Well, it's going to be a print. I'm going to use that as a printing.
Is it? And, okay.
Yeah. So all the backers are going to get a print copy of that image.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's great.
Yeah. No, I mentioned it to you.
Did you?
Yeah.
Julius mentioning it to me doesn't really do anything.
It's, well, I told you, I remember telling you, oh, I'm going to use it.
It's a two-part thing. You have to say it, and then I have to remember that you said it.
Yeah.
That doesn't always happen.
No, yeah, I'm going to use it as a print. So the backers are going to get a print copy of that image.
Yeah.
Well, among other things that they're going to get.
That's awesome. Oh, that's great. Cause that's wonderful exposure too. I really appreciate that. Absolutely. That's going to be awesome. So, and like Gambino is doing like, he's going to have writer's cramp by the time he's done doing all these sketch cards.
Yeah. He's ready for it, man. He's ready and willing this week. I want to reach out to the backers and, you know, have them, email us with the requests if the commission backers, the commission, the ones who backed the perk for the commission. I'm gonna email them.
That first day, I was like, "Holy shit, this guy's just like, is he afraid he's gonna get bored with life? Just draw all the time."
I don't want to say he has a lot to prove. He wants to prove that he belongs. That's what he wants. That's what he's doing. It's admirable because I think that's what every combo creator should go for is to thrive, to like myself included. I wouldn't turn down a writer for hire job if they came knocking on my door, because I have a kid and I want my kid to, you know, have food in her mouth and clothes and a roof over their head.
Yeah.
So I'm not opposed.
It's a good driving force too. Not just that, but your kid is, there's what you do for a living, and then there's the thing that you're passionate about.
Yeah, I want what I want, what I'm passionate about, to be my living.
The thing that your kids notice that too.
Yeah.
Like when I was doing nothing but like, you know, custom paint, and I still do it on the side, you know, when my kids, you know, if their friends ask them what I do, they don't mention my job. You know what I mean? They don't say, no, this is, you know, my dad works here or whatever. They talk about my art. You know, this is the thing. This is like, who are you? Who's your dad? What does he do? Your kids are going to talk about this. You know what I mean? They're not going to, unless they, you know, they're like,
make that's sure the goal, man. That's the dream.
Yeah.
That's the dream.
And it's, you know, it's that thing where you're going to be, influencing your children that way, where they would then not just know that it's okay, but then maybe even be expected to be more than just the thing that you work at. Unless it's like, this is the thing that you do for, I would love to be just down here all the time working on a comic book, knowing that I'm making bank doing that.
Right.
And until that happens. And, you know, I don't want to be so anxious and in a hurry to get this book out that it ends up looking like crap and doesn't do anything. But it's like if you saw it before, I was showing pictures of this giant cupcake that I was working on through the week because these people needed it right away and there was nobody else to do it. And it was a contact through a friend, and somehow I felt obligated. So I, you know, I went and I did it, invoiced. There's a, somebody screwed something up at the motorcycle dealership and they were asking me for help. And that thing's actually turning into a monster. Things that I know how to do that I don't necessarily want to do, but there's money on the other end of it. And I need that because I'm going to end up talking about it again, Julius, really quick. There are people who are coming over tomorrow to dig a giant hole in my yard under the deck, which is where the septic tank is. I'm not on a sewer, town sewage here. We have a septic tank and the lid has collapsed.
Ooh.
Right. And there's a giant 20 by 12 foot deck over it. So there's some room under the, between the deck and the ground where they have to dig, but it's still a big project. And I still don't know that that's what the problem is. I may end up spending thousands more to have something completely and totally replaced. That's what's been on my mind. And so that's when somebody says, hey, I have a job here doing the thing that you're trying to get away from so that you can do this comic book. I'm like, yes, I'll do it. Yes, I'll put down this comic book so I can go make that money so that I can fix this thing, so that someday I can either rent / sell this property or whatever. But at every other waking moment, I'm like, all right, sit down with the iPad or come down here and work on this page or try to sketch something out or something like that. And that's around the 8 hour a day thing and the other stuff that comes with, you know, you're like being a dad and running errands and all that stuff. And it's weird. It's like, you know, these passions are going to be the thing that keeps me from getting healthy sleep. Because I would rather be doing that than going to bed. They're rant over. But okay, so you got, I can't honestly, I had to look and see which one of these I backed, because I think it was, I know I don't ever do digital. I think it might have been the level 1B or 1C sketch. I'm not sure. But you have some pretty decent, this is the featured one. This might have been at Sketch Card Bundle. This is probably the one I went for.
That's the feature now, but I think the feature before was the 9x12 commission.
That was is the that, feature. Oh, so what you're saying is in demand, this is all good, but before, so whatever I did is not.
Yeah, when it was live, the feature perk was the book plus the 9x12 commission piece.
And you're going to send my own artwork back to me. There's something about that that's just really cool. In fact, I'm going to have a good time if I do an unboxing video of this. That's going to be the part that I spend the most time on. Because none of this is. But so this is in demand for how long?
I'm thinking probably by maybe the end of December or early January is when I'll close it.
Okay. So not too far away.
No, and then we're going to do a second chance. You know it. We're going to do a second chance campaign in March on Kickstarter.
Okay.
And I probably will also have a second campaign coming up in the, around the same time for a different project.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, is it a continuation of a previous project?
No, it's a new one.
So you're going to have three titles out there?
Yep.
Okay. All right. Because I still want to know what's going to happen to what is it with these fruit flies, man? The weather's been really good here lately, and I think that's what it is.
Yeah, man.
It's like 70. It's just Pennsylvania. It's like 75.
Oh, okay.
You know.
Yeah.
I know you're used to that kind of thing.
I think it's 75 now.
November 6th in Pittsburgh is not. It's nice. We take what we can get. All right. So this is cool. Apparently this guy's in his underwear.
Yeah. And there's a reason why there's a reason why he's in his underwear.
Ah, right. Oh, I see. Yeah. Cause hooked around that right foot. And somebody thought they were going to get some. Yikes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I love this stuff here. Are you, and maybe this is inside baseball stuff, or you don't want to, this stuff will be in the book. Like, do you do any, are you going to have any of the, like the process type stuff?
We like do. Montrum, yeah, we have a behind the scenes, behind the scenes book that we'll provide to whoever backed that perk, and they'll get the inside scoop as to how Gambino designed his characters, the notes that I provided him, the references I provided him, as well as how I came up with the idea, where how it evolved from it originally supposed to be a story about a aspiring UFC fighter who ends up, I guess, accidentally or through by chance getting involved in saving someone from human trafficking in downtown Los Angeles. And it went from that to this, it evolved from that to this, where the main character,
the mother of all gender swaps. It happened at the beginning.
Well, yeah, because, you know, because my wife, my wife was the one who suggested it. She was the one who told me, you know, this story would be a lot more interesting if it was a girl escaping this instead of a guy.
Yeah, that's typically where most of your kidnap victims are.
And it was a writing challenge. I'm all about writing challenges, so I was like, you know, I've never written a woman before, a woman protagonist, so fuck it, I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna give it a shot. And
you plan on, and maybe this is spoilers, and you don't have to answer if you don't want to, but one of the things that I have always enjoyed about the heroine versus the hero is them being able to use that, whatever their like feminine wiles are, or being clever, or like the woman is going to have to, because they are, you know, biologically.
Yes. That was a challenge.
Strong, that there's gonna, she's going to have to use her brains.
That was the challenge.
Yeah.
When I wrote, that's why I went for it. Cause I was like, you know what? That's a challenge. I'm gonna go for it. And
go to your lovely wife and say, let me put you in this chokehold.
Show me how you're gonna get
out of it. Cause I need to finish writing this page.
I didn't do any of that. It was all imagination, man. It was all me sitting in my wife always calls it daydreaming. Because I sit there and I literally lose myself in my mind.
Right.
Picturing the movie in my head and wondering, okay, how is this character going to get out of this? And then me figuring out a logical way of what the character's going to do.
Then a convincing way. Yeah. It's got to be believable.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, not believable, plausible.
Yeah. I guess that's what I meant. Yeah.
Because,
he doesn't have to write. I wouldn't say accurately, but he does have to write convincingly.
That's the key.
Yeah.
To a good writer. That's what Robert McKee wrote in Story, which is when you write a character that's a electrician, you don't need to be an electrician to write the character. You just have to make the character plausible enough where even an electrician can say, oh yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's accurate.
Yeah,
but in reality, you were just playing.
Yeah, you were just swinging
it. Yeah, but in reality, you were just swinging it because you're a writer. You're not. That's not your job. Your job is not to inform the reader what an electrician does. Your job is to inform what the character does in a dire situation.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, it's like was that one book that I read, Patriots, that literally is written as a fiction, so that you can, and it's simultaneously teaching somebody about a diesel engine or brakes or how to store stuff or how to stitch something back together, working on a piece of chicken to practice sutures or something like that, because that was the point of that book, where in a traditional writing, that is the last thing that you want to do.
Yeah. You'll bore the audience to tears.
Right. Know. Right. But when you get into it and you know that that's the point, that's one of the things that was really unique about that. Like, okay, yeah, I understand. Okay. Two pieces of plate steel instead of one. Blah blah blah, or you know, he gets into like technical stuff about working on CB radios and things like that, and you know why they're doing it, but it was such a huge jump from a traditional, you know, writing thing. It would made the book a lot thicker, but it was just a different way of delivering that information, and it was, I'm surprised it actually worked. bot. Okay, so and you're but you're writing the tell me again about this screenplay.
Oh, The Last Thanksgiving. Yeah, Chris Hicks is the producer of the, and director of this movie, and he months ago was looking for a writer to help him develop this story idea he had called The Last Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he didn't give the name of the he didn't give the title of the story. He just said he wanted to do a horror story that involved Thanksgiving. So I, you know, threw my name in the hat, and he got back to me, and we got to talking, and we got along, and so he decided to hire me amongst the various other writers who mm-hmm. contacted him, and he sent me his outline, and I, you know, typically if something doesn't work for me, I've gone to a place in life where I'll tell the person, you know what, this isn't working.
Dude, I'm not even there yet.
We need to change it and this and that, blah, A, B, yeah. and C.
What are you saying? Like you're not super sensitive to the idea that you might be delivering bad news to somebody, because
I understand this is also a business, and
oh yeah.
And you want to get your money back if you're going to put something out there, especially if it's a comic book or a movie or whatever entertainment you want to put out there. So when I read his outline, I was like, hey, this is actually pretty good. I kind of like what he has here. And mm-hmm. so I got back to him. I told him, hey, this is good. I'm on board. Like, what, is it okay if I tweak some things though? And he was cool with this. So I tweaked some things without changing the foundation of the story.
Right.
And I gave him the edited version of it, and he dug it. And we hashed out the plot in detail as to who was gonna, you know, do what and
uh-huh.
what was gonna happen, that kind of deal. And then I started writing the script for the comic book. And I finished it within, I think, 3 months. I think I finished it, because he told me I couldn't write no more than 50 pages. So I was like, all right, cool. You know, that's a challenge. Another, again, a writing challenge. Oh, no more than 50 pages. All right, let's see if I could do this. And that's I got in at 51 pages. Mm. So I did all right. I did all right.
Yeah. Well, that's like that person who's like, I'm trying to lose 20 pounds. So I lost 19. I'm good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's see. He's in his last 10 years processing his own processing.
So he, the story, the outline that he wrote is essentially a homage to the 80s slasher movies.
Mm-hmm.
So Halloween, Friday the 13th, the other ones that came out in the 90s too, like I Know What You Did Last Summer, Scream, that kind of stuff. And so the modern twist is that this slasher, this monster, right? Because in the 80s, you know, Michael Myers was a real person, but he had elements of a supernatural monster.
Because, okay, yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, he would appear out of nowhere when you're running away. You would hurt him, but then he would disappear, and then you wouldn't know if he was dead or alive. You know, the same thing with Friday the 13th. But the modern take is that it's a, I don't know if it's a spoiler. I don't know if it's spoilers or not.
You don't have to
say. Or whatever the case, he was very happy with the script that I wrote. He was very happy with it. He was excited, and he wanted, you know, he was ready to produce the comic book, but then things fell apart, when it came to that kind of thing. So
mm-hmm.
he was going to shelve it completely. And he told me, hey, I was thinking about making this into a movie. What do you think? And I was like, hey, it's your project, man. Like, you do whatever you want.
Yeah, and that's that was one of the things that I was curious about. Like, is he just want to produce it and somebody else direct it? Or is he?
No, he's directing it. He's producing and directing it.
Why does that logo look so familiar? Not, I mean, the one up in the corner, I swear that's. Do we know him? Like, have I seen him on Twitter?
Yeah, Vengeance Productions.
That's what I thought. Okay. Yeah. Duh. All right. Shit.
And he decided to
why are you working with me? Oh man. You know what? This is like, have you ever imagine somebody told a joke, everybody laughed at it, and once all the laughter and the din died down, that's when I go, oh, oh, I see what you did there. Yeah, happens, I think, man. I'm following this guy. So he wants to turn it into a movie.
Movie. So I'm adapting it into a screenplay, and it's a different challenge for sure. Because right. Now it's going to be dialogue heavy, and I love writing dialogue. So I'm really excited about it. But now I'm wondering, damn, how is he going to shoot that? When because I wrote a few scenes for the comic book that the artist was going to draw, and if the artist was going to, step up, it would have been a great, set of horrific, bloody pages, very violent, bloody pages.
Yeah.
But now he has to shoot it. So now it's like, oh, crap, how is he going to pull this one off? Because this one's pretty fucking intense, that kind of deal. So he's, he has the right mindset. I like his approach. He's going to go for all the streaming services. Amazon, Shudder. He wants to do this into a full-length movie and really make this into a straight-up, like, B-movie quality, straight-to-video movie, which is great. I think that's
the... What's the thing? I don't want to, put my math skills up against anybody else's because I suck at math. But the $2,000... as a flexible goal, so clearly he can make more than that if he wants to, but I've never heard of even an independent film getting off the ground without at least another zero.
Yeah, you're right, but not necessarily. I mean, El Mariachi, Robert Rodriguez made that movie using film, by the way. I think he used 60 millimeter film,
mm-hmm.
for $7,000.
Okay, all right.
And he just had his he was just hungry. He was just hungry, and he made it work. He figured it out, and essentially, when he sold it to, I think he sold it to Columbia Pictures, because they were really impressed at the fact that he made a full length movie at $7,000. They're really,
yeah.
That alone impressed the producers of Columbia, the executives at Columbia, and on top of that, it was a complete story. It told a story. It was well done. And so they added, I think a $700,000 for reprocessing the film.
So he basically, they just wanted to put more flesh on the bones.
Yeah. And then they added the budget for the advertising promotion, and the movie ended up raising the box office. The limited release on top of the DVD sales and VHS sales at the time, total of $2 million. So $7,000 to $2 million.
Oh, it'll work. Oh, and I know why I didn't notice is because I'm following him on Instagram.
Oh, okay.
And he's got the digital. Maybe I'm whatever.
Well, the trailer that he has on the Indiegogo is essentially
probably watch it.
Yeah, it'll give you a good idea how he plans on shooting it in terms of aesthetically speaking. So it's a
here. I'll get rid of the spinning head and I'll hit play. Is it very long?
No,
it's only a minute 17.
Yeah, it's long. So there you have it.
I was muted, and I wasn't even on the screen, so you couldn't tell that I was talking to no one. You couldn't see that my mouth was moving and no sound was coming out. Well, that's cool, man.
Yeah,
it's interesting. Although I might have punched up the title at the end. It looked, I mean, he had the, his character was washing out the thanks. In Thanksgiving, you know what I mean? Like it was like kind of blocking out the title.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Images were competing with each other. But other than that, okay, so let's see. You got your book, and you know, I'm hopefully we can do another stream like this whenever it comes time to actually get this book going. Because I know if there's, you know, things I don't know about the software I'm using that I'm learning. I mean, I know how to work, you know, digital, you know, media, but you know, coming up with, you know, some decent music. One of my customers does, he's got like a recording studio at his house. We were talking about this story, and he was like, "Yeah, let me know when you need some music for that trailer. We'll do something." It's like, throw me some influences, things that you want it to sound like, and we'll go from there, and it'll be like totally original, not what do you call it, royalty free music or something like that. And I'm sure I'll have to stripe something in exchange. But that's what I love about bartering. You know, when somebody comes to you and says, you know, hey, I'll be happy to help you out.
Yeah, it's always a good thing, right?
Yeah, yeah. And it's in a currency of talent, which is bottomless. You know, you can run out of money.
Yeah, but you kind of ran out of talent. That's what they
are. Not as easily, no.
No.
it's going to take a lot, like, you know, losing a limb or something. Yeah. Do not save. I've been, like, working in all of these things. Now I want to make sure that I don't screw up any of these pages now that I brought them up. Ah, man, I am just super excited to get this. I feel like it's moving faster too. Like page 4 took forever. Page 5 didn't take as long. Page 6 is moving a little bit quicker as well. And on that note, and I know, geez, I've been talking for like an hour and 44 minutes. I am super glad that I got your content and on the movie too. And in your book, but now that nobody's watching, I can cut this off and we can get into that other business. So it's the actual reason why you showed up here.
Yeah. Yeah, let's get started, because I gotta head out soon.
Yeah, all right. Great. So I'm gonna end the broadcast. Everybody like and subscribe. For those of you who showed up tomorrow,
do you want to like button, leave a comment?
Yeah, exactly. Do all that stuff. Only good comments. I can't take that kind of criticism right now. I'm very fragile. So have a good rest of your life. If I don't see you guys again, and peace out.